Hi, my name is Robert Munro, and I've just built that bike that you can see there. Just 3 weeks ago, it looked like this. A bunch of parts that I'd sourced from 20 different suppliers worldwide, looking to build my dream bike. First off, I had to build the wheels. This turned out to be the hardest part for me, the thing that I had never done before. So I got spokes from the best person I could find, which was someone who handmade them in Canada. I got rims from some great suppliers. This is me building an internal roller hub, and this is my friend Jenny showing me how to build a wheel. Fortunately, she's built one before, so she was able to show me how I could gradually add the spokes one by one, go through, carefully tension them so that there are no buckles in the wheels, make sure the weaves were correct, so ultimately I get that balanced wheel. I wanted to cover the frame with a protective paint coat. All right, that's awesome, thank you. There we have it. So we go from the original black steel Surly Troll frame to the green frame that I've got right there. Ditto the rack. Next off, it was time to build a wheel solo. So using the first wheel as a reference, I built my front wheel. So this is the free spinning front wheel on my bike. As you can see, these rims are 26 inches, otherwise known as the standard mountain bike rims. I always tour on a mountain bike because I do most of my touring off-road. Typically through mountains or forests, because you know, that's where the world is most beautiful. So this is me gradually building this wheel. You can see those spokes are curved to begin with. That's because of the way that they weave in and out. That weave means that they spread the tension among multiple spokes, makes them less likely to break. And as you can see, it comes together with the spokes straight and hopefully with even tension. Next, I had to put the crank in. So this is the part that the pedals ultimately connect to, that goes around in the middle. This was actually the one part they ended up having to replace. So this part of the time lapse is a little bit less successful. That crank ended up getting replaced. And then here I was putting the tires on the wheel for the first time, and I managed to break three tire irons trying to get this wheel on. So you can see my frustration there. After that, it was mostly smooth sailing. So this next part, look closely, because what goes from a bunch of just disparate pieces sitting around becomes a bike very, very quickly. So I get the wheels on, I get the seat and suspension seat post on, and then the handlebars, and look, it looks actually like a real bike. Almost rideable. The pedals go on next, and there it is. But the hardest thing next for me was working out how to connect and install that rear hub correctly. It's just an internal gear system. It's much better than external gears because you can change without needing the bike to roll, which is great when you're touring and you're stuck in mud. You can go up and down gears very easily that way. And because it's internal, it's really easy to maintain. You have to replace your oil every few thousand kilometers, but that's it. And as you can see, I was spending a lot of time reading the manual, trying to look for instructions online. So there it is. That's the bike looking pretty much like it's meant to. So now, the next most complicated part was installing all the cables. So this is me ensuring that the brakes are on correctly, and that they're connected to the levers on the handlebars. Ditto the cables for the rear hub. I bought brakes which go on the rim rather than disc brakes because they're easier to source when you're touring internationally, and because they put even pressure on both sides of the wheel. The torquing disc brakes has caused me to pop too many spokes, and the discs themselves I've got damage in the past. And so this is the final part of the build. Now having got a bike that is completely rideable, I've got to do the remaining bits and pieces, like in that case putting the tape on the handlebars. I have cork tape and some gel padding underneath to ensure that's a smooth ride on those, as you can see, butterfly handlebars. Those butterfly handlebars give you a lot of different places you can put your hands so that as you ride over time, over the day, you can put your hand in different places, change your angle a little bit, and it stops you getting too weary. Then it's putting everything fun touches together. So put in the rack on the back, which is what the penny is, the bags will attach to, and putting the attachment on the front of the handlebars, which allows that bar back to go to. So at this point, it should be a good bike. But just to be sure, I asked the guys at my local bicycle store at Valencia Cycles to have a look over for me and actually ultimately replace that crank. And here I am testing it out. I rode through the Pacific Northwest, started in Seattle, joined my brother who joined me in Vancouver, and we rode from there up to Whistler, mostly off-road, going over obstacles like this and ensuring that, yeah, this was actually a bike that I can take anywhere in the world, being sure that it'll remain sturdy and there will be replacement parts wherever I need it.